I'm Pat Wheelock, and on behalf of the Cultural and Education Committee, I'd like to welcome you to our second program this month. If you missed the first, we collaborated with the Environmental Committee to host Howard Wainwright, retired park superintendent for River Park North, who shared his expertise about the many birds in Cypress Landing, and I'm sure some of you came and heard that excellent program. This program will be available on the website very soon, so if you missed it, go looking for it, okay? Tonight I have the pleasure of introducing Jason Raupp, an assistant professor in the program of Maritime Studies at East Carolina University. Over the past 20 years, Dr. Raupp has been involved with maritime and terrestrial archaeology research in many parts of the world. Dr. Raupp's research interests include historical and maritime archaeology of the Pacific Ocean, Latin America, Africa, and the Caribbean. Culture contact, history, fisheries, military technologies, battlefield studies, and public archaeology. Recent investigations by East Carolina University's program in Maritime Studies provide insight into the sequence of industrial activities that took place in the waters of the Pamlico and the Tar Rivers. Several of us were enjoyed the lecture, the program he did about half a year ago at the Brown Library, and we thought what he brings to this program would be something that would be of great interest to you. His presentation provides an overview of the important components of Washington's port, discusses the results of both terrestrial and underwater surveys around the area, and considers the significance of this largely forgotten industrial landscape. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Raupp.
Thank you so much. Well, first I want to say thank you very much for inviting me. I've known of Cypress Landing for a long time, and it's really nice to actually see what a beautiful, beautiful place this is. So before I get started, I'll take a little turn. It only occurred to me on the way down here that we are basically looking out over a really, really significant part of the heritage of the Tar and the Pamlico. In that you have a site that was documented prior to the installation of this marina. A shipwreck out there, I think, that pointed out that there was a little sign there. So we refer to it as the Cypress Landing schooner. But it's a very, very interesting type of schooner. I won't go too far into it. But it was a project that was undertaken by East Carolina University in the 90s, prior to the development here. And it's really unique for the Pamlico in that it's a scow type schooner. So it's a very specific type of schooner that when I hear that, I think of places in Europe, or I think of the Great Lakes. So I don't really think of this type of vessel being used on in North Carolina, but it also has these hallmarks of Eastern North Carolina's vessel types, which is they're scooters and they have centerboards. So that will sort of lead us into what we're going to talk about today. But so before I get started, I just wanted to first say thank you again. I'm not from North Carolina. I might sound a little bit like it, but no, I'm actually from Louisiana, and so I have really my education was down in Florida, but so I've studied a lot of things across the Gulf Coast, and then when I decided to do a PhD, I did a PhD in Australia. And so so North Carolina was always just very tantalizing. Friends lived here, and I was this close to coming to the ECU program in Maritime Studies, but took a little bit of different tack, and I'm glad I did, because I think that helped me to eventually land this job. So anyway, so just to start, I always like to kind of give recognition to our program when I give talks in this region. So The program in Maritime Studies at East Carolina University has been around for a very long time. And a lot of people recognize the name Texas A&M when we think of maritime archaeology because they, Dr. George Bass, investigated the world's oldest shipwreck and things like that. So they've established that program about 50 years ago. Well, that was a very much an Ivy League program that was established in a very non-Ivy League place down in College Station, Texas. That had something to do with funding and things like that. Around the same time, you had a group of guys that were interested in doing something very similar. And one of those is Dr. Bill Still, who just passed away last year at 90. Bill is an amazing, amazing historian, and he is one of probably the most recognized maritime historians in American history. Some of his work has become like the standards for consideration of Confederate shipbuilding and things like that. Bill and Dr. Gordon Watts in the lower image there decided that they wanted to start a program, but they didn't want to focus on the world's oldest shipwreck in the Mediterranean. They wanted to focus on something of a more modern period. So the idea was the program of Maritime Studies, they were really a couple of Civil War nerds, basically, and they really wanted to study Civil War wrecks in these rivers. And so they shopped it around and they ended up at ECU. Dr. Watts was on faculty at the time. Dr. Still. Dr. Watts was the first state underwater archaeologist in North Carolina. So they came to Greenville and founded the program in 1981. So we have probably the second oldest program. But what's, I think, even more important is internationally we have established a name recognition that I don't think anyone that hears the name East Carolina University could look at a map and say, oh, it's right there in Eastern North Carolina. Right? I have no idea where Greenville is. But they certainly know of our program. So we have had an amazing success rate with this program. I've been here about 10 years. The program's been around, you know, roughly 45 years. We have a 71% graduation rate in the program. We have a 76% job placement rate. So these numbers may not mean much if you're outside of academia, but in academia, for any program, these are just phenomenal numbers. But to think of something that's as esoteric as underwater archaeology, and to think of that not being in crystal clear blue water of the Florida Keys, but instead in these murky waters out here, it says a lot. So anyway, a lot of what I'll talk about tonight relates to this, and I steadfastly hold that there is a reason for that. And I think that is because a lot of the archaeology we do is archaeology you cannot see. So you have to learn, you have to understand what it is you're looking at, and then it's a lot of touching and feeling underwater and saying that's that thick and that's that long. You know what that is? I think that's that. So your eyes and your hands become very much interconnected. So other great things, we've worked all over the world. You know, this is an image from the Marshall Islands. We did a project a few years ago. So we do programs, our projects all over the world for any number of reasons. A lot of what we've been doing in the last few years is the defense vehicle, the UMIA accounting agency projects, where we're trying to assist with the recovery of lost service members. So anyway, enough about the program. I just always like to try and, you know, make sure that people locally understand just where we sit internationally. So the Tar and the Pamlico rivers, you know, have a long history. Clearly, prehistoric people use these areas. And around Washington, we really take it back to around 1760. Now, we know that Bath was founded in the early 1700s. And eventually, there were land grants awarded further up the river. Eventually, this area, Little Washington, has a really nice, deep, natural deep water port. And so over time, they planted the area, they farmed the area, etc. And around 1760, they decided that they wanted to establish a township there. So grants were given for 5-acre lots of land right around what is now downtown Little Washington. And they established a community they referred to as Forks of the Tar. I'm getting ahead of myself. Our our first field schools. So we should probably take this back a little bit and say that back to the East Carolina program in Maritime Studies, clearly our field schools would have been, in those early periods would have been local. Now we run field schools everywhere, we do things all over, but we also still work locally as well. So I'll be running a field school up in Edenton on Revolutionary War wreck in the next couple of weeks. But our first field schools were right around Castle Island because there's a number of ships that were abandoned there around the early 1900s. So diving and water safety, it's really great, this low water, low visibility environment. And so a lot of theses have focused on this area over the last 40 years. And so what I'm talking about is our more recent stuff, but I'm also really keen to try and reach out to some of our alumni who are now retiring and see if they want to contribute, because I think it would be really great to put together a compendium of maritime heritage and maritime archaeology of this region. But there's so much to do here, and I say that because we find things are reported on a pretty regularly because they have these crazy blowout. You guys experience these nor'easters and nor'westers, and they blow all the water out into the deep channel, and they just expose shipwrecks and maritime heritage. So we were out just across from Little Washington 2 years ago, and we were shuffling around trying to find something, and our dive safety officer kicked a wreck. So now it's called the Mark wreck. So there's just so much to do. So much to do. This is just one example. This is a map that was found by one of the students that graduated just a few years ago, who incidentally is coming back to North Carolina to work with the state agency. When Will was looking at his thesis, you'll see this is Little Washington here. This is a map from 1872, just post-Civil War. And you can see blown out that it actually covers quite a bit, all the way up to Trainers Creek and the split to the Tar. And then down, you guys are right up there. Anyway, but all of these marks on this chart are telling us that there's heritage in those spots. And it really, it's just kind of mind-blowing. Because you can see things like these fisheries, where they put in all of these piles, these wooden piles, to establish fish weirs to sort of trap fish. But also you can just see marks for wreck. This is that south coast from Little Washington. When you look out, it's just a completely natural environment. Well, in the 1800s, that wasn't the case. In the 1800s, there was a booming industrial area over there for turpentine. And so what we found was the remains of cribbing. And so this goes back to probably late 1700s, early 1800s. But one of the things that I was really fascinated with was this line that's drawn right here to a wreck. And that wreck, I think, is marking USS Pickett, which is a Civil War vessel that's just right out off in the channel. But that line of piles, I was looking for something else, and I ran into a pole when I was diving, and then I ran into another one and another one. And it's a wonder we didn't hit it with a boat, and so I finally started digging into this, and it turns out those are Civil War obstructions. So during the Civil War, they put in those piles to try and choke the mouth of the rivers. So you had to pass through a certain area. So anyway, this is just an example to say that there's so much that we can do right here locally, and a lot of what we've focused on in the last few years is this particular site of Castle Island. So I'll talk more about that. So I thought I'd just jump into some of the projects, since this is really a discussion of our more recent stuff. So in 2020, we started our field school. We started looking around for ideas for wrecks that would be good. Now remember, 2020 was a pretty interesting time. We were the only school in the world, to my knowledge, that was able to pull off running a field course. And so that was because we didn't use boats, but we had to find just the right site, right? And the site we found was right next to shore. Went out and did some schmoozing with some locals, and they allowed us to use their yard, and we had students lay out towels 6 feet apart. They'd sit and eat lunch and like look at each other. But then they're in the water with one another diving. But anyway, but this was a really tough project to try and figure out how to do this, because we didn't want to just say to the students, well, sorry, that was your year, and your year just happened to be that you don't get the training. Because again, I say, there's an old joke about ECU, and that is that it's kind of the ECU mafia. So everybody that graduates from here gets jobs because the people that are hiring are people that graduated from here. And that's not just because, you know, go Pirates. That's really because they know that if they hire kids from ECU, they know they're going to get people that are well-trained, and that they're not going to have to teach them on the job, because we spend an awful lot of time in the water with them, and we spend a lot of time training. So anyway, we started looking around for sites, and you can see this kind of hazy image here. This is from Dr. Watts, and he's just sort of like, oh yeah, there's this here, oh, there's this there. So just trying to make sense of this, when he gave this to one of our professors in the 90s, I think. So I finally was like, what does that one say right there? Schooner, all right, let's go with that one. That looks pretty close, that looks good. So we ended up calling it the Short Street Schooner, or the Copper Wreck, because when we went out and looked around on it, we noticed that there were some weird copper fittings that were coming out of the seabed. And so this turned out to be a really fascinating site. Hasn't yet turned into a thesis project, but it's coming. So what we've got is this site. This site is situated just offshore from an old sawmill. Now, this sawmill has a really amazing story. So this was the E.M. Short Mill. So remember, at this time, what North Carolina in general was really, really known for up through the early 1800s, this is in the 1880s, was timber production. So a lot of what the colonial production was not necessarily the logs themselves, but it was turpentine. And it was anything that you could extract from the pine. And they called it naval stores. They referred to it as naval stores. You used it as tar and pitch to treat the seams of ships and to keep ships watertight. So by this point, Little Washington had established itself as sort of a sawmill town. And it would then develop into a shipbuilding town. But logs would be cut further upriver, brought in to the river, dropped in the river, floated down. There would be vessels out just the other side of here to catch those logs, bring them over to the sawmills. They would then bring them up on shore, mill them with huge saws, and then load them back on barges to be shipped out. The E.M. Short Mill particularly serviced several folks up in the New York area. So a lot of this North Carolina pine was being shipped up, probably for shipbuilding. The pine was used for the decking and several specific parts of ships at the time. So the E.M. Short Mill was really crazy. It begun in 1878. And you can see from this map, this is a map, an insurance map from the 1880s. And you can see how well-defined the shoreline is right around the mill itself. Take a note of that. Because notice that back in this other area, it still seems a little bit natural. It's got the really bends and things like that. But you've got a very squared-off seawall there. Just a little bit about the E.M. Short Building. This particular mill has a really interesting connection to Washington because of its because in 1885, E.M. Short himself showed up at the mill and found that there was a problem. So what was happening was the boilers were steaming as hot as they could be, but they were low on water. So what they think happened was, in a knee-jerk reaction, he just turned water to the boiler. Cold water, hot boiler, explosion. They refer to this, and this is why I can't figure out how none of the students want to take this on. I would have jumped in. They say that when this happened, the explosion and then the concussion from that was such that it shattered all the windows in every building in downtown Little Washington. They say that this incident was the biggest thing that occurred between the Civil War and World War I in Washington. Like, this was, that had that big of an impact on the community. So, a really interesting place. Once he had short, really didn't make it after that. His son and his wife, tried to run it for a while. They eventually sold to the Eureka sawmill. Some of you guys might know from images and things around Washington. Eureka was a bigger operation just across this little inlet. And that's where, if you ever see on that low tide, or if you see them during the blowouts, there's all this stuff sticking out of the water down, sort of when you're going up towards the Tar River. That's all the remains of the old log pens where they would hold the logs. So this is, you know, looking from the bridge, you can see that there's a schooner right there, okay? Now, again, this is the sawmill, this is the history, but we got really interested in this because this little cutout right here, and Dr. Watts had mentioned this in that map, that there was a schooner there. So we've not been able to figure out exactly which vessel this is, but we just assumed, you know, that what we were looking at was a vessel that was either wrecked in a storm or was maybe left in place. So went out and started talking to local folks about it, and it turns out the people that own the house, one of the houses just there, they were, goodness, I don't know what's going on. They were able to share some images from one of what they're called around here is blowouts. I don't know if you guys call it that. Washington chocolate, I don't know. It's like street gangs or something. Anyway, they all refer to these as blowouts, these big blowout events. And so the guy was having a dock put in at the time, and they had this massive blowout in 2000, and it exposed a shipwreck, and you can see the barge was sitting over the bow of the vessel. So when the water went out, it actually did some damage and crushed a bit of that. But regardless, you can see the current seawall that's there, and then you can see all this stuff sticking out of the water. So some good detective work by one of the students. Now, we took a group of students out again. This is during COVID, so you know, they're probably a little closer than they should have been, those 6 feet. And scuba regulators acted like masks, I guess. I don't know. We have a pretty good dive and water safety group, and so they like sprayed bleach on everybody's regulators, and we're like, go ahead. Nobody got COVID. Like, we made it through. We were the only ones that did one, and nobody got COVID. So what we did was, what we're seeing now is that technology is really rapidly changing for everybody in society, but quite honestly, for maritime archaeology, it's finally catching up. So we've always mapped sites in a very specific way, where we stretch tapes, and then we do baseline offsets or trilateration. We have some very specific and standardized methods for mapping ships so that we can create an image of what we otherwise can only feel oftentimes. So we reverted to that. Nowadays we're using cameras a whole lot more, and it's truly amazing. I have to give that talk too. But what we did was we established a grid type system, a coordinate system on the site. We had the students work in specific areas, and then as they completed their drawings, you can see, this is Dr. Jennifer McKinnon. So then we take the little square sheet that they have, and we line them all up, right, until it all makes sense. Or we tell them, go back in the water and figure it out. It doesn't make sense, which is oftentimes the case. But that's okay, because I really truly feel like that's how they work. And this is what we produce. So we ended up producing this really pretty detailed map in the site's in about 3 feet of water, 4 feet of water back in the stern. You can see this is the bow of the vessel and this is the stern. What you're looking at is not clearly the vessel as it was built. It's a deteriorated version of the vessel. So we're looking at different portions of it that are visible above the mud. And then there were also some portions and pieces of machinery in the back that we were curious about, because when we first dove on the site, visibility was absolutely zero, but we could feel these sort of copper things. We had the light, so we were seeing the shine of the copper. And that's back in this area. So we thought, well, maybe this was a steam vessel, and then maybe that's what we'll find out. But in fact, it wasn't. So what we were looking at, we think, is a small schooner. And what was really curious is that we think it's just a ubiquitous sort of Eastern North Carolina coastal schooner. Would have been, looked something very similar to this. There's examples of these all over, right around Castle Island, the little island in the river across from Washington. This is one of the wrecks that's there. And you can see a few images of this type of vessel. They were used for all kinds of things, transporting goods, oystering, all kinds of fishing, things like that. So the construction itself, we noticed some pretty unique things about it, some things that we still scratch our heads, right? One of those being, pretty standard things like a double framing system. So we know that it's a pretty well-built, heavily constructed vessel. So probably something that could work out in the sound, certainly could work offshore, probably isn't something you're gonna take overseas, right? You're not gonna go across the Atlantic in it, but so it's probably something that was built locally and used locally. We were able to do a profile of the bow of the ship, and so clearly we use all of the things we have at our disposal, treatises and things to understand this. So this is very much the various types of timbers that are used. Everyone has its own name in shipbuilding. Same thing in the back. So this is the actual rudder itself. So this is the stern post. So there's a lot there. And there's that piece of copper. We had a day where we had good visibility. Now, what was really curious was that as the students were mapping it, they kept talking about how they're like, no, how is one side of the vessel just straight, but the other side's curved? What are you talking about? So anyway, as it turns out, we came out with a device called a RTK, a real-time kinematic geospatial navigation satellite system, something like it. Anyway, it gives us pinpoint accuracy, and we're able to basically take points as we walk along. And it's a really, really amazing piece of equipment. We got very lucky. We were able to get this. It's about a $45,000 device, but it is proven to be well worth its weight. Just for what we were able to determine. So through that survey, through their surveys, and through some insightful interpretation, I'd say, we noticed that it looks like you have former seawalls that are in place. And then this vessel lays almost perfectly next to it. So this was really interesting to me, and it started to make sense that some of the other things, like the machinery in the stern that we were seeing, started to make sense as well. Because what we're thinking is, if you think back to that map that I told you, how you had a very sharp lines, the seawall was very well established. I think that's what you're looking at, is that original seawall that was put in for the short mill. And instead of this being a shipwreck, I think that what we're looking at, based on artifacts, based on the things that we were finding on board, coal, things like that, I think that the vessel was basically purposely placed there. Because if you were going to build a wharf, you're going to have a huge financial outlay. So you want to get out into a little bit deeper water that will allow you to get a little bit bigger boats in to load your lumber on. So if instead somebody says, hey, my brother's got an old boat, great, bring it up, and suddenly you've extended the width of your wharf out another 20 feet. So bring it up, put it in that place, knock some holes in it, and let it sink. So that's what we think's happened here, and that's why we think we have this machinery that we found back in the stern area is actually probably part of the same kind of machinery you'd see here, where you had windlass barrels and winches that were used to basically lift these giant logs onto the deck there and then onto the shore, and then load them back on the barges. So it's a pretty neat site. I really, really enjoyed like mapping that site. I mean, they mapped it. That's a pretty confronting image there, but so some of the artifacts we found really do fit the time period, sort of the late 19th century. We have just things we expect to find, like bricks, various pieces of mortar and things like that. We had also different types of glass that might have been involved. And at this point, you're thinking it's not probably artifacts that are associated with life at sea, but instead probably people using this vessel, you know, for after hours, for fishing, for any other number of things. Like this bottle that at the very bottom says, this at the top says, not for resale. So we know that that's post-1930. So, and we were able to figure out that that's a type of brandy. So we have some really good students. That's a PhD student of ours who graduated in 2 weeks. And it's a port bottle made by Pedro Lopez and Company. 1935 to 1964. So anyway, again, the site interpretation, I think it makes a lot of sense. I think it would have made sense to like a redneck like me in Louisiana to just bring an old boat up, and suddenly I extend my wharf out by 20, 25 feet, and that puts it into a little bit deeper water. So suddenly I increase the efficiency and the economic potential of my operation exponentially. So in that same field school, we had another wreck that we, so weird is that? We had another wreck that we looked at, and that's, we refer to it as the centerboard schooner. Many people from Little Washington, I think, know about the centerboard schooner because their boats have made contact with it. Because most of the centerboard schooner is gone. But the centerboard itself, which is about 4 feet tall and just below the water surface, it's just in a pretty precarious spot if you're over there trying to fish or have a good time or whatever you're doing, and then bam, we noticed that there are several instances where you can see it was hit, and including maybe or maybe not me, maybe or maybe not somebody by from ECU. So the centerboard schooner is, this site was first identified again by Gordon Watts, our knowledge. It was another site that we had students at the time who were looking for master's thesis topics, couldn't really do a lot of traveling, so a lot of what we were thinking was, let's look in the backyard and find it. So we spent some time on this wreck, and it's just a really funny, like, serendipitous story. So you can see the centerboard schooner situated sort of on that same shore that I mentioned before. So that shore, again, would have been in the early 1800s. That was a big spot for transporting turpentine. So ships would come up, load turpentine and any sort of naval stores and things like that, and then go back out through this great channel. Now, by the time that we think that the centerboard schooner was deposited there, it's probably abandoned. So there are several wrecks over in that area. We haven't really investigated many of them, but we did. In 2004, Dr. Nathan Richards ran a seismic sonar survey, and you can see the outline of a ship, and then that's that really, really precarious centerboard. So we knew that the wreck was there, and we had a student that was really interested in fisheries, and that's something that I do a lot of. I've studied fisheries all over the world. And so I was working with him. We decided, oh, let's look at oyster vessels in the Chesapeake. Well, we didn't get to go to the Chesapeake. So instead, I said, I don't know, maybe this is an oyster vessel. Turns out it is. So just a little bit of background on that. The Chesapeake oyster industry, the United States oyster industry, Chesapeake oysters are known around the world. What people don't know is that basically they overfished the Chesapeake pretty quickly, and then they started looking for other areas. Well, North Carolina Sounds make a lot of sense. They came down here, they start to harvest oysters, they ship them back there. Whoa, the world knows Chesapeake oysters, not Pamlico oysters. So clearly the Chesapeake, I won't go too deep into it, but the Chesapeake oyster industry, fishery, was massive. And it really very quickly grew. It started as something that just poor people ate oysters just like they did in the Gulf, just like they did everywhere. Oysters were just something that you could easily access, and it was sustenance more than anything, but it wasn't something that, until branding came along, I guess. But over 10 million bushels of oysters were caught in Maryland itself each year, Maryland waters, so imagine the rest of Chesapeake. Oyster fishers fought over multiple incidents. I found this to be super fascinating a few years ago, that there was actually oyster wars. North Carolina had oyster wars. There was a ship that the North Carolina legislature outfitted a cannon and put armed soldiers to go out and sort of stop what was going on, because people were basically threatening to kill each other over their oyster claims. Okay, so the realization that oyster beds were really quickly depleted. So again, they start to look other places, and folks found North Carolina. So North Carolina's industry was really, it was just mostly, it was for local consumption, like so many different fisheries up until around the 1870s, 1880s. They were really, fisheries were just something that people knew that they had. They didn't really have a taste for it. It was just part of your diet. So oyster industry never really expanded that big in North Carolina until we started to see the influx of folks from the Chesapeake. So that's really because of the distances between towns in North Carolina. So you have your major ports like Wilmington or Edenton or Beaufort. So, you know, instead it was really on a local scale. In the 19th century, North Carolina clearly saw a rapid expansion in the industry, and oyster canning facilities were established in major areas, especially Little Washington. So Little Washington had developed around 1890, the oyster canning factory employed 150 people. And there's really crazy, like anecdotal stories, like the streets of Washington were paved, as it were, with oyster shells. But that's interesting, right? Because you think, wait, oyster shells would cut up on tires. Nobody had time. Anyway, also understand that because of oyster shell being put down, as horses stamped them down, as people walked on them, they basically solidified to create lime. So that actually created a really, really good base for the streets of Little Washington. So, unfortunately, the Chesapeake Bay folks didn't learn their lesson. They overfished here. Washington Oyster House was owned by a Baltimore firm. Clearly, they're not going to be Pamlico oysters. They're going to be Chesapeake oysters. And so the cannery ran until around 1920, when an overall decline in the oyster populations. If you go to the North Carolina Maritime Museum in Beaufort, there's a small little plaque, a little framed a document on the wall. You would miss it if you weren't kind of looking for it. But it basically is it's an early scientific questionnaire, right? So by the 1880s, they were actually playing with the idea of culching, right? And I guess culch probably comes from the concept of culturing, like aquaculture. So basically, when a lot of the oyster shells would be reused. So shuck them, put them back on a barge, take them back out to an area and replant them to try and build new oyster areas. So if you go out to the mouth of the Chesapeake, down around Wysocking Bay, some of these areas, Spencer Bay and stuff, this is something I'm still trying to get somebody to do, but there should be experiments from the 1880s of early fisheries studies, fishery science. So it's kind of like science of the science or something. Anyway, I'm trying to get students to look at this stuff. So as you see, this is the J.S. Farren oyster packers. Now that is situated where the estuary is now. So that is exactly there, directly across from that little island, Castle Island. And the Farren and Co., this is Sanborn maps. These are entrance maps from 1891 and 1911. You can see some expansion that had happened. But the thing was, is this wasn't a consistent industry. So it would operate for a few years, and then they'd see a decline, or they'd have a bad projection of how many oysters they were going to get that year. So they sort of, you know, pull back in a little bit. These are some of the vessel types that they used in the Chesapeake. There are some very specific types like bug eyes and skipjacks and pungies and sheep pungies. There's all kinds of things that are very specific vessel types that when you find them underwater, you can actually say, like, absolutely, this is a sheep hungy, which is what my our former student Patrick Boyle came to find. So various vessel types, these are actually in operation in Little Washington. These are the images we could find so far. So this is how we documented the site. This is myself and our diving safety officer, Mark Poisonkoden, out on the site during field school. You notice we're 6 feet apart. So basically what we did was we established a baseline, and then we mapped from that baseline everything taking 90 degree offset measurements. So, and then the student came back later and sort of created a color coding to make sense of what it was he was finding. And it was a really fun sight because it really started to look like an oyster vessel. And this was the thing that this young guy wanted to look at. So we were excited. You notice here, this is something that I have never experienced up to this point. That's a mast. And it just looks like maybe it got hit by lightning. So, but you can undoubtedly see it was just laying next to it. And I was like, well, maybe if I could just get this log out of the way. As it turns out, it's a mast. So everything we did was, you know, we don't really use this term, but it was, you know, it's almost like a blind person reads Braille. Right, so everything you're doing is just absolutely zero visibility in this area. So that degree of that site plan is a real testament to our students and their capabilities. What was great was when we started actually finding artifacts that with every one that, you know, we'd feel something, and we had a permit from the state that if we found something that was really significant, we could bring it up to the surface, take photographs of it, and then put it right back where we found it. And in this case in the beginning here, the first thing we found up in the bow were these rakes, and we were able to identify those as oyster dredges, so the rakes, the teeth from the oyster dredges. And then we found a leg from a stove, which they would have cooked oyster soup. And then we found this roller, which would have brought the dredges back on shore, and it's very specific. There's no question of what it is. So what we came to find was through Patrick's project was that this is a very specific type of vessel, one of only maybe 30 that were built. And it just so happens that it ended up here, and it was, again, through really, really, really good research that was undertaken by the student. He's now doing a PhD down at Texas A&M, looking at oyster vessels in Virginia. Really, he did an amazing job. We don't know exactly the name of the vessel. We don't know if it is exactly one of these 30 or if it's one that was built locally, but undoubtedly it is a bug eye with a very specific type of mast step that tells us it's a sheep hungy. Okay. So next I'm going to just move on to Little Washington. I know my stories are probably getting long. But so Castle Island was another area that was really interesting. And really, this is, again, this is this COVID period where things are starting. We're all kind of coming out of the hibernation. You know, we're all starting to get to a point, but we really still couldn't travel. So the year before we did the Little Washington, the 2019, the field school was in the Marshall Islands in the middle of the Pacific. The year before that, it was in Costa Rica, and so on and so on. So we hadn't been doing much locally, only for the students in 2020 to be like, wait, what? Aren't we going to Costa Rica? No, we're going to go to a ditch. We're going to go dive in the ditch. So we always refer to North Carolina waters as either root beer or Yoo-hoo. This is Yoo-hoo. So you don't see much around here. But this site in particular is really fascinating to me because Castle Island is, you know, situated right across. This is the new development there at Moss Landing. That's the estuarium. So Castle Island is a neat place in that you just see the maps of it and you don't and it doesn't make sense, right? It doesn't physically make sense. How is there such a big island when every historic map shows there's just one small little island there? So archaeology helped us to do some digging on, or to expose some of that. So we had, we knew that, before I get started, we knew that in the late 1990s, Dr. Bradley Rogers did some field work around the around Castle Island, and we knew that there were at least 10 vessels. We've actually identified two others now, but there's it's a ship's graveyard is what we refer to these as. So just basically places where, well, it's not like it's in anybody's way. Just let it sit there for a while. We may need it again. But just hold on to it. At Louisiana all day long. Yeah. Hang on. Don't get rid of it. Just put it in the yard next to all the mother cars. Anyway. Anyway, Little Washington has this ship's graveyard. But there's other parts and pieces of it that were really, really interesting to me. So a little history of Washington and how Castle Island works in. 1705, Bath, North Carolina's first town. I kind of went through this earlier. 1771, we established Forks of the Tar. Clearly, there's, you know, some activity during the Civil War. Everyone's really proud of George Washington. George Washington, his name is given to the town of Washington, right? Little Washington as in Big Washington. So George Washington himself, this is the first town in the United States that's named after George Washington, right? That's really cool. Okay, George Washington was at maybe like Goldsboro and had an opportunity to come here or go to Raleigh, and he was like, I'm gonna go to Raleigh. So George Washington actually never really visited this, which would have led me to probably say, you know what? Let's name it after somebody else. Anyway, so 1790s, Washington really starts to develop rapidly. But remember, and this is kind of key for later, but that whole 1771, right, the establishment of this town of the Forks of the Tar, there's already communities around the 1760, the community starts to build. So by the 1820s, we know that shipbuilding becomes really popular. Sawmills are being established more and more. Think about, you know, the steam engine is really starting to become something that you see more. Maybe not necessarily on board vessels, but certainly steam power is in operation. So this is the burgeoning sort of, you know, industrial revolution. By the 1860s, the Civil War has an impact on Little Washington, on Castle Island itself, became a, you know, the Battle of Washington. And by the 1890s, lumber, lime, agriculture, and fisheries were really what made Washington, what established its growth, right? So Castle Island itself is this little nondescript little, you know, island out across the river here in the middle, right? This is from the Civil War. You notice it's the rebel batteries are here. So these are the forts. Castle Island was fortified, but not enough to call it Castle Island. We'll get to that. So in the 1780s, John and Thomas Blunt put warehouses out there. And they aid with privateering activities and shipping in the Revolutionary War. By 1818, Fowl Brothers, there's still the Fowl Mill, the Fowl Corporation. One of the major buildings downtown Washington is the Fowl Building. So they establish shipbuilding on Castle Island, and it's referred to there as the castle. And so the implication is that there were smokestacks that were in place for things like the foundries and like blacksmiths and stuff like that. And so the tops of the smokestacks gave the impression of a castle. So it's this fortified structure, right? The crenellated tops. So it's fortified during the Civil War in the aftermath. And 1890, lime and fertilizer, the Washington Lime and Fertilizer Company established a large brick kiln there. And we knew about this like from historical records. But everybody we spoke with said, oh, there's nothing out there. If you go out there, there's nothing. Go kayak out there. You won't find anything but copperheads, you know, cottonmouths. You don't want to be out there. So anyway, 1893, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers takes over the island and establishes a depot and a shipyard. The lime kiln operation is sold off in 1911, and the island's pretty well abandoned. Now, in the 1930s, and this is kind of a key factor to what I talked about earlier. You see this image here is from 1938. This is a mid-19th century drawing of what Castle Island would have looked like. 1938, you have this aerial photograph, the earliest one I can find. And you start to see that extension of that island, right? In the 1930s, they started to dredge this channel. And all the dredge spoil that they pulled up from there, they just started to throw at the end of the island. And so that's why you see now this massive island. That's why we also couldn't find out who owns that island. But you also can see, if you were up close, you can see that there's the remains of a ship there that's been taken away. So we got really kind of interested in it because of this project that they did in the 90s. Dr. Rogers was at ECU for 35 years. He investigated these 10 wrecks around Castle Island, and then Hurricane Floyd hit. And we all know how devastating Floyd was to this community. Well, they went back the following year, and several of those vessels were gone. So Floyd had such an impact that they were either buried or they were just broken apart and just washed downstream. So we were lucky to have the project, you know, and in many cases, I guess it's a whole different discussion, but, you know, we're seeing a changing climate for whatever reason, and we're seeing that sites, archaeological sites, are being impacted. So we're doing our best to try and record things as we find them, because we know they may not be there. So in this case, what we saw was, this is a side scan sonar image that we did in 2020. And we started seeing some things, and we thought, okay, well, we'll run our field school. We can't travel, so we'll run the field school around Castle Island. There's one thing in particular, and it's this old wharf that you can see that sticks out there. And nobody had really talked about it before in any of the archaeology that people had done. Dr. Still or Dr. Watts or Dr. Rogers, any of them, they'd all done a little bit of time out here. So we decided to go back, run a field school, and investigate this. And this is really good spot. What is out there is, this is an image that Ray Midget from the Historic Port of Washington Museum, which is developing now, has. This is an image that Ray had of a blowout, and you can see the remains of a structure there. You can also see, I don't know, is that a train? There's something out there, we just haven't had a chance to get over and look at it. But you can see it gets pretty crazy out there. So we had the students map that. Because it was really interesting. I always think of these things as battle axes, you know? It's kind of that axe head that goes out. And you can see that it's stacked timber. So this is a top-down view. We call it a plan view. And this is a profile from the side. So then you had cribbing. So, you know, like Lincoln log, right? Like old Lincoln log houses and things like that. And that's how this is built. And all of this is ballast stones. So these are stones that ships would carry to keep them sort of low in the water before they took on cargo. So they may come to Little Washington looking for naval stores or, you know, tar and things like that. So they'd take that stone and they'd throw it into these cribs just to help establish the wharves. So we had the students map it, and it was pretty neat because we started thinking, like, you know, like based on the way this is built, this is probably a little bit older than we thought. And then the students started finding ceramics. And so it was just a great moment of maybe a disconnect between me and the students. But one of the students was like, "Hey, are you interested in ceramics?" And I thought, "Well, I'm an archaeologist. Yeah, I'm interested in that." But so they started finding all of these artifacts around the wharf. These just busted bits of ceramics and things. Dr. Jennifer McKinnon was out there with us, and she's done a lot of ceramic analysis over the years. So we found things like this pipe stem. You know, this is a pretty good indication of an early 19th to late 18th century object. We found some really, really old, like Native American pottery that's about 2,000 years old. So we kind of exclude that from our discussion of the more modern use of the island. But basically what we started seeing was things like Deptford, different types of ceramics that started telling us that maybe this was older than we thought. So we did a mean ceramic date, is what, you know, we just average all the dates for these types, and it came out to around 1790. So I was really excited about that because, you know, I mean, that's a lot older than I think we give this part of the state credit, right? So we go through, we start doing a little bit more investigation, and you can actually see this is these really beautiful days where we actually have a little bit of visibility, where you can see the remains. This, they not only had they established this this wharf, but they actually the entire structure along this this side of the island is visible in the side scan sonar image. So they took the time to build these cribs and float them in. So this is a really, really important place. And we know that through some of the things we see, like you can see this little gap here that was filled in later, I think this is probably evidence of shipbuilding. This is the deepest part of the channel right here. I think that basically this is a 52-foot wide gap that was later on filled in a different way. And I think basically this is that 1820s shipbuilding, and that they filled it in when they built that sawmill, because that sawmill was built out over the water so that they could float the barges right up to it, load the barges, and there you go. So we also noticed this sawmill building, so we decided to brave the copperheads and the cottonmouths and all the things we were told and do a shore survey as well. And so we were investigating another wreck, which was just a little bit up, and it's an old ferry vessel that used to operate across, bring you folks over to there, to that side, I guess. and so we were looking at this ferry vessel, and another team with Jeremy Borelli and Dr. McKinnon were on the island, and what they found was not what was reported. So we knew that there should be the remains of some of these buildings, could be there. And we also knew that you could see other things like the remains, you know, you see these dots in the sonar image? That's the remains of the log pins. So as they were floating those timber, all the logs down the river, they pull them in there and contain them within that pin. So all of this you can see in these historic drawings and paintings of this. This has really, really been a fun project. Now, the other thing that we thought was really interesting was that we started to notice the remains of buildings. So we think that this could be one of these you can see in some of the drawings. What I guess it to be is probably a blacksmith shop. I think if you started digging there, you'd find lots and lots of things that would be associated with blacksmithing. Because you wouldn't have a sawmill that wouldn't have that kind of capability. But the most interesting thing was that we see the remains of possibly one of these warehouses, which is shown on here. But what we really found was the remains of a lime kiln. And this is another example of why the heritage in this region is so important. This lime kiln is the only one of its kind in eastern North Carolina, probably on the East Coast, is what we found. So this is an image of one from like Colorado, things like that. But we were trying to create the idea that what we're seeing is the remains. Captain Styron is building three 7,000 to 9,000 structure kiln for creating lime. So the oyster fishermen are bringing in the oysters, they're shucking them, they're canning them, then the shells are being brought across, burned to create concrete. So everything you see in downtown Washington, that's all oyster shell concrete. Right? All of those early buildings, that's all, it's David Soselsky is a really wonderful historian of North Carolina. He had an article about a world made of oyster shells. Yeah. So we basically have this huge lime kiln structure. It's 9 feet high. It's eroding into the river on the eastern side, but there's nothing on that island. No, we actually had to take machetes and chop our way into it. It was like, I just pictured, like, Dr. McKinnon's my wife. And I just picture her and our staff archaeologist, Jeremy, just like Indiana Jones, basically, like, cutting through. So, anyway, I got really fascinated by this. We ended up buying this tool that is called a resistograph. And that is basically, it's a little tiny drill. And it drills in the timber, and it basically is used to tell you the density of the timber, okay? And so it's used by folks, it's made in Germany. We own one of the only ones that are in the United States. We're the only archaeology team that's using them. And there's a few of them that are in use on the Great Lakes, I think, where they go to jetty or piers, and they test the pylons to see how dense they are. So we decided that we might be able to use something like this to tell us how long shipwrecks might last, right? the level of those. So this is Olivia Livingston. She's one of our students. She's writing a master's thesis on this project. Because what we found when we did a little bit of training with this resistograph was that it also counts the rings in the tree. So if it counts the rings, then that may give us data for dendrochronology that would say, when was the tree cut down? Right? So we decided we were going to try this. Maybe it worked, maybe it didn't. Oh my gosh, my slides are all mixed up. Okay, from the hip, Liv's project, really fun. So we reached out to a guy, a dendrochronologist at Radford University in Virginia. And he came down last summer. We took dendrochronology samples. And this is the first time, I think, that this has ever been attempted, was to take dendro samples from an underwater site. Because what we wanted to do was we deployed the resistograph, and we wanted to see if the rings that it was counting would compare to an actual dendrochronological sample. So the verdict is still out, but what our colleague is pretty comfortable saying is, around 1760, he thinks those trees might have been cut down. So remember, 1771 is the force of the tar, right? So it's all making sense. I'm really excited about what's going on. And I'm sorry, for some reason I must have saved the wrong PowerPoint. But to that end, we are actively working here. This summer, we decided instead of working here on the Tar River, we would take our operation, our circus, and move it up to Edenton, because we knew that there's a wreck that was investigated in 1980, one of the very first attempts at a field school by the program, and it's been interpreted as a Revolutionary War ship. We are really excited about it because we've got some new insights, and we think that maybe it was misinterpreted. Certainly it fits the period, but stay tuned, because I think it's going to be really exciting if we can prove what we think it is. And the best part is we'll take that, and we know that the 250th anniversary of the Revolutionary War is just a few years away, so we think it was pretty timely to try and get the students to focus their efforts on that. But we'll also take students down around Wilmington. There's a site, if you've never been, it's Brunswick Town, and it's an early settlement in North Carolina. We also have some really interesting data that we've recovered through sonar surveys down there, including a wreck that we hope, well, there's a ballast pile that we hope might be a wreck. If it is a wreck, then it could be very significant. So not to say that things aren't just as significant here, but, now I will close by saying that we work collaboratively with folks all over the world. We have collaborated with folks at NOAA, the POW/MIA Accounting Agency, Sea Grant, North Carolina's Underwater Archaeology Branch, the National Park Service. Well, quite honestly, they all employ our students. So we work with them a lot. Some of these images are from Saipan and the Mariana Islands and the Florida Keys and Great Lakes and Great Lakes. So we work all over the place, and we still like to think that this is probably one of the most significant places that we do conduct field work. Thank you very much.
We have time for a question or two if there's anyone in the audience.
Yes, ma'am.
So have y'all done anything with a picket?
Ah, that's the funny one. The picket's like a really weird sight to, it surprises me that no one's ever done anything more with it. But it's kind of tricky because it's right on the channel of the river. So you start in a few feet of water, and then you end up in 10 feet of water in the channel. So I don't know if that's what scared students away. I know that they used to do a lot of the black water training with our diving program, and the students would always get lost in the picket. It's a really fascinating sight because it's a steel ship that they built a wooden hull around. It's complicated. It's a ship that needs to be investigated.
So what type of vessel was that?
A steamship.
And
do you all do anything as far as aquaculture at ECU?
We don't, but out at the Coastal Studies Institute, out at Manio, there are a couple of professors there that are doing like oyster research and aquaculture.
Thank you.
No worries. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I think you can sense the enthusiasm that Jason has for this topic. Wouldn't you love to be sitting in one of his classes, or maybe diving with him? Well, we thank you so much
thank
for
you
being
so much
with us. Our next program will not be the second Sunday of the month, which is Mother's Day. It will be the third Sunday, which happens to be May 19th. It will feature a duo of two musicians from Oriental by the name of Hoff and Finch. They do music from the 60s through the present time. Very entertaining. It's going to be outdoors, at least we hope so. If the storms enter the area, we will have to make a decision, so you just have to pay attention, and if it's not outside, it'll be in this room. It's on the Marina lawn, and we're going to start a half hour earlier at 6:30, so we can give them an hour and a half of daylight, 6:30 until 8. If you like, bring a picnic dinner if you want to. There will be a satellite bar set up downstairs with wine and beer. So there'll be some information coming out, so please put that on your calendar. Thank you for coming this evening. We certainly appreciate your attendance. This is very important to us as we work very hard to get some fine speakers like Jason this evening, and please thank him one more time. Thank you.